Good morning. Welcome to the Blue Quill Angler. We're beginning our live stream presentations on Saturday morning, and we appreciate y'all coming today. Today I have the privilege of giving my buddy Joe Schaefer a big hug. He came to me about 10 years ago and said he wanted to be a fly fishing guide. And he is a sheriff. So I didn't know if I really wanted to have a sheriff out there putting arm bars on people and stuff. But Joe said, well, I got 3 days a week I could guide. And so we started down the road together. And, you know, right out of the box and feedback I got on his trips was really great. People were very happy. They were catching fish. And Joe asked me, well, what can I do to be a great guide? And I told him, well, give your wife at least half your tips. So he's been a fantastic person to work with, and he has brought a lot of joy to a lot of people who wanted to learn to fish and people who wanted to go out and explore Colorado and have a great time. So Joe, he's going to put together some of the things that he's learned in the past 10 years. So, Joe, thanks a bunch.
Thank you, Jim. Okay. Appreciate it. Thank you. Thanks for that great introduction from Jim. I really appreciate it. So let me explain to you a little bit about myself. A lot of people don't know who I am. Like Jim said, I've been a guide for about 10 years at the shop, but I guide part-time. I grew up fishing in a small creek close to Boulder, on South Boulder Creek, okay? And that area is now a private fly fishing club, so I don't even get to fish it anymore. So sometimes it comes full circle on you a little bit, right? But that's where I hone my skills. My grandmother actually was one of the first ones to teach me how to fly fish. She's in her 90s now, still going strong. She's a great lady, taught me a lot of things. I actually got to fish with her. My Uncle Dave taught me all I knew about casting, okay? He never, barely ever took me to the water. All I could do was go in the back of our little cabin up there and cast at rocks and bushes and things like that. So it honed my skills. So that's kind of where my tactics kind of started in fly fishing, okay? As Jim said, I've been in law enforcement for about 18 years, okay? And it's a great career path, if anybody out there wants to do it. Of course, not everybody likes us, right? But it's a great career, and I've enjoyed doing it. But I've also kind of developed things from that helps me in my fly fishing, and that's what we'll go into a little bit more. I have a beautiful wife. Like Jim said, I took his advice, okay? And I gave my wife my tips when I came home, right? So even if I take a trip, okay, and I go out and the guy pays me on his card for a tip, I hit that ATM on the way home, okay? Because I got to bring something home for her, right? Because she has that handout ready to go. So, but no, she's a great lady, puts up with all my fly fishing endeavors, and I love her to death. I have two beautiful girls. Both of them have been fly fishing since they were 3 years old. They're great to take out on trips with me, and they're learning the intricacies, and hopefully someday they'll become guides. So I really enjoy that. I'm also a pro staffer and signature tire for Holly Flies, okay, which they'll be selling in the shop here pretty soon. And then I'm also just became the owner of my own fly fishing company, Joe Schaefer Fly Fishing LLC. And we have a website that basically I want to show everybody what I know in fly fishing and get it all out there in front of everybody. So that's kind of my background on who I am. Give me a show of hands, everybody that's here. How many are new to fly fishing? Okay, great. How many people have advanced into fly fishing? Any guides here, anybody like that? Some more of you are more advanced in here? Okay, great. All right, how many business people do I have in here? Okay, how many sales guys? Other, right? Other, great. So what we're going to talk about throughout this whole thing is we're going to relate our tactics back to what we do in our everyday lives. You're used to doing that grind at work every day, right? You're doing the same things all the time. It may change within your life skills, all your different things, and relating them back to fly fishing. The reason I do that is because in my line of work, right, I got to have something to look forward to on the weekend, right? So got to get excited about something because you see so much bad stuff. You want to think all that good stuff and relate it to what I do every day, okay? So that's kind of what we're going to go into. These aren't just my tactics. I don't want you to follow my tactics, okay? I'm just going to give you examples of how I relate it back. What I want you to do is relate it into your own tactical plan, okay? So a little bit about, I'm going to start off with a story here first. So you kind of know how much I love fly fishing here. A few years back, me and Bob Dye, most of you might have heard of him, great guide here at the shop, okay? I had a little altercation during the week, okay? And I had actually twisted wrong and popped a rib in a fight, okay? Well, guess what? Next morning, I'm supposed to be at the parking lot at 5:30, me and Bob, we're going to go to the top of Cheeseman Canyon, you know, 3 miles in, and guess what? That rib, I woke up and I thought it was puncturing my lung and everything else. It was pretty bad. So I didn't tell Bob when we got there. We started walking up in the canyon and Bob hears me just all the way up the canyon steps here. We get to the top and he's like, Joe, what the heck is wrong with you? And I said, Bob, I have to tell you a little story here. I got a little injury yesterday. And he's like, you're an idiot. What are you doing? I'm like, don't worry about me, Bob. I'll fight through it. So we go all day long netting fish. We happen to have a great day, so walking on rocks and netting fish, that's great for a popped rib, right? So we go all day long. We come back out, and Bob's like, I can't believe you even made it through that. And I was like, either can I. But that just gives you a little bit of taste of how dedicated I am to fly fishing and how much I love it. We're going to cover equipment here. We're going to cover casting. We're going to cover some rigging stuff. We are going to go all through basically beginning to end what you can adapt a tactical plan to your everyday stuff. And now we're going to go into equipment here. Okay? Those rubber ducks up there, we put a too hot hook on that, right? We can drop that in the water. It'll float all day, won't it? Yeah, you never know, we might catch a pike on that sucker out of the Colorado. But so equipment-wise, okay, I always tell people, be organized, okay? Don't go out onto the river, be learning a new tool that you're going to mess with, rigging, things like that. You know, make sure your boxes are organized. Make sure that your whatever you're carrying with you is very organized. Because I see so many people on the water, they're out there messing. It takes them 10 minutes to re-rig because they're trying to find boxes, things like that. If I do that with a client, I'm taking away from their fishing time, right? So we always want to be organized. Keeping your equipment stored, right? Like in law enforcement, if I didn't have my stuff in the right place on my duty belt and I needed that, I needed to go from defensive tactics to my weapon, how would that look if my weapon's not in the holster? That'd probably be pretty bad, right? Or it could actually kill me, right? So a lot of that is placement, manipulating it, okay? Working with it. I wouldn't pull out a tool in law enforcement if I wasn't trained profusely on it, right? I wouldn't want to use those tools. Because if I did, I could be in trouble if I did, right? Or hurt people that and things like that. So we want to make sure is that we use those equipment and everything with it and specifically follow the same steps every time as we pull those out, okay? Storing this stuff, we all know, if you don't store it in the right places at home, what happens? If I leave my duty belt around, okay? Of course, I always put my weapon up, but if I leave my duty belt around, the girls are trying to handcuff each other, you know? Same thing with my fly tying equipment or my fly fishing equipment. I come home one night, my wife's doing her nails with my nippers. Okay? We've all had those experiences probably out there. So let's keep our stuff stored up away from everybody. That way, when I go to get it each and every time, I know exactly where it's at, and I know exactly where everything is in the equipment, and I can just pick it up and go. How many times have you been on the river and you, oh, I left that box at home, or I left that piece of equipment back at the house or in my car? Okay, it's very unorganized, and then you have to walk all the way back, right? It takes out of your fishing day. Okay, that's part of your tactical plan, is making sure all that equipment's ready to roll. Okay, make sure your waders and boots, when you put them away, that they're actually in whole pieces. I've had clients show up for trips and they pull them out and their whole sole is off their boots. Okay, that's why I always carry extra, just in case. So that stuff happens all the time. So in thinking equipment and building that into your tactical plan, make sure you go through that stuff. Take that little bit of extra time to make sure your equipment's right. Okay. Casting. This is a very important part of fly fishing, but I think this is one that people overthink a lot. Not everybody can feather out 60 feet of line like Jim Cannon. Okay. And if you guys have never seen it, come by the shop and ask them to show you, because it's pretty incredible. Okay. But a lot of situations on the river and building into our tactics with casting, okay, we don't need to have those 60-foot casts, right? The main two casts that I apply all the time, okay, are a tension cast and a roll cast. You have those two casts, you can do just about everything in fly fishing that you need, okay? And the key is to those, though, is that we can put them in there accurately. Okay, we don't have to take much time. We don't have to take a bunch of swings over the top of fish heads to make those casts in there, right? Because we know a lot of fish in Colorado, they're so spooky, okay? You make a bad cast over the top of their head, what are they going to do? Shoot out, right? We won't even see them anymore. So making sure that your casting is very technical. What I liken it to is like when I go to a shooting range, okay? When I go have to take my tests, so I can carry my firearm, okay? This is a good situation where you can pick out targets. You have to go systematically through different shooting cycles, okay? Close, far, in between, okay? Behind stuff, in stuff. So same with your casting when you're out practicing, okay? I tell people all the time, go to your local pond, go to your local stream, practice before you go out on a trip. So you're ready to make those specific casts, okay? Pick out rocks in the lake, pick out a bush to cast to. Whatever it may be, make those different casts to those different things. Have a purpose in mind and goals you want to set for yourself. If you want to be able to make a roll cast 20 feet and pop it on a rock, practice that till you start getting it, okay? Everything in fly fishing takes practice. It's not necessarily like riding a bike all the time, is it? From my experience, guys. You have to keep working at it, okay? Some more casts that I like to use is a steeple cast. Why? Because we got all that stuff behind us, right, on the river. We got bushes, things like that. We come up to the 12 o'clock position, work it back down, stop abruptly. Those flies pop on the water nicely. Great cast when you have things behind you, okay? Same with the roll cast. Haul and double haul casting. Okay, this takes work, right? How many people have done hauls or double hauls in your casting? That's good, okay? We have to work on that stuff constantly, especially if you're rolling streamers a lot, things like that. You want to put a little bit further casts out on your dries, okay? We have to work on those double hauls even more, okay? And I'm sure they'll be happy to come up here. If you come up to the shop, they'll show you how to work all that stuff. Bow and arrow cast is another great cast that we use all the time. That's, people think it looks funny and it doesn't work that well. But a lot of times under bushes, under tree, under deadfall, okay, you can pop that bow and arrow cast in there real simple. Okay, that's a real effective fly or a casting technique. And you can get into those little areas where fish love to hold. Okay. So we're going to go into rigging here a little bit. I kind of liken rigging to in law enforcement, and if you're a business guy, like setting up for a presentation, okay? Or for law enforcement, it would be if I go into a fight and I only have one option, probably in trouble, aren't I? Okay? I have to have several different options to be able to go to and work through. So when I'm thinking of relating that back to the rigging part, I want to have a bunch of different options that I go into. If I just fish the same method every single day, okay, and I do the same techniques, the same rigging, everything, am I progressing in fly fishing? Probably not, right? I want to try a different bunch of different things. And as we go through this, I'll show you some different options that I kind of throw in here. So the first setup is a nymph rig without an indicator. There's so many different types of this, right? We got all this popular Euro nymphing, things like that coming out, okay? A lot of the setups are basic, fly line. If you're really into the Euro nymphing and things like that, you want to get a fly line to match that, okay? And come to the shop and they'll set you up with all that good stuff, okay? 7.5 foot, 9 foot leaders. Those can go bigger, smaller, depending on how you build them. I tend to keep mine a little bit shorter in the nymphing rigs without an indicator. That way I have a little bit more control of the flies, okay? We'll put a weight above the surgeon's knot, okay? We'll attach that. We'll go 18 to 24 inches. People see that, they laugh. They're like, you put them that far apart? Yes, sometimes, okay? Bigger water, I'll tend to lengthen my flies a little bit. Smaller water, I'll tend to shorten them up a little bit, okay? A tractor fly, it could be scud, it could be San Juan worm. Great flies to use on these, what I call a tractor fly or a point fly in this system, would be the new jig type flies. That's good because it gets them down quick, bounces off the bottom. Those hooks usually ride up, so you don't get as much snagging, okay, on the bottom of the river. I'll put another fly in between that, 18 to 24 inches, depending on the situation, okay. That fly, I'll match the hatch that's going on at the time, okay? That middle fly tends to be more of what exactly is going on or the next hatch that I see coming, okay? That way, I like to, especially on my nymph rigs, is try and fish three different types of flies. So I may fish an attractor fly, a scud pattern. I may fish a caddis and then a midge behind. Okay, and we can change those up throughout the day. If you're definitely on a hatch, say you're on a trico hatch or bluing olive hatch, you can go double bluings there, okay, if they're really hitting them. The fish will let you know what's happening, right, because you'll be catching them, won't they? We'll do a third fly. Not all the time will I use three flies. Just depending on the situation, but a lot of times, why fish one when you can fish two? In Colorado, we can fish three in tandem, so more options, right? Tip it to 18 to 24 inches to the last fly. A lot of times, that last fly I'm running as a merger because it's going to be riding a little bit more up from the other two because of the weight position here. We can also change those rigs like that. We can put a weighted fly at the bottom, keep those flies down, put those attractor or the matching bugs up above that weighted fly underneath. Now, if you think about that situation, your back fly is getting down and it's holding those upper flies in the current, right in that feeding zone, okay, depending on where those fish are at in the feeding zone. If the fish are on the bottom, we want to get those flies to the bottom, right? If they're suspended up in the system, okay, if they're in that middle column, sometimes it's better to reverse where you have your weight. Put that weight on the bottom. Let those other two matching bugs for the hatch stay in the current. So that's kind of how I'll run my nymph rig. So an indicator nymph rig. Of course, great option for tons of different situations. Okay. Of course, we want a floating line to that leader section. 7.5 foot, 9 foot leaders are always great. I tend to go with 9 foot leaders here. That way I can cover all different types of water. If I get a real deep run, I can extend that indicator up and drop down into deeper runs. So we'll put the strike indicator on somewhere in that leader length, a good basic area to look for in that indicator system is we want to be about 1.5 times the depth of water, which everybody's told that, right, when they start out. But is that always the case? Heck no, right? We're going to change that depending on the situations that we see. If we add weight, if we subtract weight, okay? We'll attach with the surgeon's knot, put the weight above the knot. That way that weight doesn't slide down to our flies, okay? 18 to 24 inches of tippet, depending on the situations, okay? And we kind of run the same fly style there, okay? We're going to put the attractor up top. We're going to have matching the hatch bug in the middle and a matching the hatch bug underneath. Same thing in the indicator rig. Some of the most effective days I've had guiding and fishing is switching around these bugs. Don't get caught up in just, okay, I have to have my attractor fly first. I have to have matching bugs after that. That is not the case. Okay, I've found that many days on the water that moving these bugs around, putting the weight in the middle sometimes works better. Okay, putting a streamer under an indicator. Have any of you guys ever done that? Okay, put a streamer on there. I'll be showing you today a fly that I use under streamer all the time. Very effective method. Okay, putting a streamer at the top or at the bottom of your rig. Okay, we can also, a lot of times, what I've adapted into my game a little bit, into my tactics, is tagging. Tagging these flies off of the different Euro examples. Okay, I'll tag flies coming off of the leader and tippet sections. And I'll put those on tags with a big weighted fly at the bottom. It makes a great, great different setup. Okay, those bugs tend to move a little bit more on those tags. Okay, so you get more action. So that's some different options that you can do with the indicator rig. In these situations too, you don't always have to have a tractor either. If I got blue wings going off and I got midges coming off, cover those hatches. Okay. A great tactic to use. Put a couple blue wings on there, put a midge at the back, float them. If they're up in the water column, take some of that weight off, grease your leader, let them float in the current. A lot of times changing things up like that will trigger strikes. Okay. Dry dropper rigs. So one of my favorite rigs to fish. Okay. In these situations, we can also do dry dropper rigs, okay? Or you guys have probably heard before, especially out there on TV land here, that hopper, copper, dropper type deal, okay? Except, of course, we don't always use hopper, copper, droppers, right? We may use a caddis up top. You can just about do these rigs for any type of dry fly with flies underneath, okay? Great thing about dry dropper rigs is we can fish different water columns at the same time, right? What I tend to do with my leaders, okay, we're going to use floating line, of course, on this. And then with my leaders, I'll typically lengthen these out a lot more. A lot of times, I don't want the extra leader, so I'll use a 7.5 foot to 9 foot leader, okay? But I'll extend off of that extra length to tip it. Okay, so up there you see 24 to 36 inches. I'll even go 2-3 feet sometimes past that. Because what I want to do with those dry dropper rigs is I still want to be able to short line nymph them, okay? Keep my fly line out of the water. That prevents a lot of those currents and stuff for changing your line around, pulling drag on your system, things like that. We want to let those float naturally. So that lengthening of that, sometimes it makes it a little harder to turn them over. But one thing to combat that with these new systems coming out are these braided leaders. They're real good. And you attach tippet directly to them. So it helps turn over your lines a lot more. And your flies will land nice and pretty, a little bit softer than with a full leader length. So that's another good option to add to the end of your fly line is those braided leaders. not stay the same. Tippet, here's where a lot of people go wrong with the dry dropper system, is they'll put their droppers 18 inches off the back of that. Okay, good in some situations, right? If we got those fish just underneath the surface feeding, that's a good place to get those droppers into, right? But what if those fish aren't feeding close to the surface? What if they're in the middle column? We want to have enough length in our tippet to get those all the way down in the water system. Okay? So what we'll do is I'll sometimes go 3 feet off the back of that. Okay? Sometimes 2 feet to that first fly in this off the back of the dry fly. Okay? And that's always going to probably be a weighted fly, that one there. And if in the dry dropper system, you can put 2 weighted flies below that, okay, if you really want to get them down. But that middle fly will be some kind of weighted fly. The bottom fly, a lot of times what I tend to do is match exactly what's going on. If there's a PMD hatch, anything like that, I'll match that exactly, okay? Make sure when you're in this system, a lot of times I'll use nylon or mono leaders, because if you're using fluorocarbon leaders on this, you're going to have to grease them. Of course, fluorocarbon has a coating on the outside of it, and it weights your line down. So if you're using leaders that are fluorocarbon, make sure you grease them, okay? I always tend to grease them a little bit anyway, just to make sure that they stay up and float a lot, okay? And that's kind of the different options for the dry dropper rig that I'll use. Sometimes it's funny, different situations may arise. A lot of these dry flies are have foam in them and things like that, so they can hold up a lot of weight, right? You can even tie small streamers, put them on the bottom fly in that dry dropper rig and fish a streamer under it. There's so many options you can do nowadays. That's just another example. So streamer rig, we got our fly line, floating or sinking. A lot of times most river situations, I'm not using a sinking line unless I know I'm going to a real deep river. Some of our rivers, Colorado would be one in certain areas that you'd want to have a little bit of a medium sink or a slow sink line to run your streamers on. But most of the time, if you use a 7.5 foot or a 9 foot leader, you can get your flies down in the column. You can add a little bit of weight to the line. A lot of times what I'll do is save up all those old leaders that you ate up through. You can put them on your line and use those, okay? You can come right off the end of the loop of the fly line and build your own leader if you want. Sometimes I'll do that just to get the length or the depth that I want to get in any given situation. A lot of times I'll run 2 streamers back to back. Sometimes run a small one in front and a bigger one in back. Look like they're chasing through the column. Sometimes I'll run an egg pattern up front and I'll run a streamer behind. Okay? Let me make it look like that fish or that leech is chasing that egg. Okay? There's a million different things you can do with this. Same as you can run on streamer rigs. Every once in a while, I'll run a big stonefly off the back of these. Okay? Or in front of it. A lot of times that'll trigger strikes. There's a million different options that you can do with it. That's just a couple, but build those into your tactics. Think outside the box a little bit. Don't always think that this is the way it's got to be, because this is what they tell us that we're supposed to do. Some of your best fly fishermen out there have the weirdest looking rig setups. It's amazing. So it's good to change it up, try different things on your different rig. Selecting and reading water. So this is kind of an area that you really have to build your tactics into. Okay, this is where you kind of start everything out. When I start my trip, this gives you something to look forward to at work. Man, you know, I got a little break here for a minute. Let me look at a Google map here. See where I'm going to go this weekend, right? Little things like that make you look forward to that weekend, that fishing trip. It's always good to have a good map of the area. Google Maps, of course, you can check out the area before you even get there, right? Know where you're going to fish. Know the boundaries. Know where the private water is, where the public water is. And then stream flows, okay? Stream flows is very important. A lot of this homework stuff I kind of liken to different things in law enforcement, okay? The changing of the day and night patterns. You know, I know throughout the day I'm going to have to look for different things happening throughout the evening into the night. How we set up for our tactical plans for when we have riots, okay, things like that. We have to have maps of the areas. We got to know where our exit points are. We got to know where help's coming from, right? This is how I kind of liken it back to my work on every day, okay? I have those maps, those streams. I know where my boundaries are, okay? Stream flows, we add to that. You know, currents going up and down, where that may be a tough day, right? If we got those changes in flows, things like that. My rule is flows going up puts the fish on the feed, okay? Flows going down, all right? A lot of times that disbursement of the fish goes out, okay? Those fish tend to get a little bit more weary, okay? They change their feeding lanes. Gets a little bit tougher to get after those type of situations, okay? Weather, that's a big one, okay? Weather, changes in weather can affect fishing. Not as much as I think people like to say it does all the time, but it's more for your comfortability, right? If I know it's going to rain that day, okay, I want to prepare for that. I never let weather affect if I'm going anywhere. I have that built into my tactical plan. I'm not worried about weather whatsoever. I'm going to fish every condition, no matter what. But that's another thing that we put into our tactical plan. How am I going to attack those different weather? What am I going to wear? How am I going to layer? Okay, fishing reports. I'll tell you right now, a lot of fishing reports are 2 to 4 weeks late, right? Most of them are not accurate at all. They're a good guide to get you in the ballpark, okay? The ballpark is kind of where those kind of lay, all right? A good fishing report, you know, some of them to look at. Pat, I know, updates his just about every week. If I put a report on my site, it's going to be within a couple days. But the deal is with those fishing reports, I look at it like I want to build my own report, okay? I want to build from the maps, the stream flows, all the different stuff that I'm putting into my bank, I want to build that report myself, okay? These things that, you know, everybody has nowadays, great tools, right? Okay? Yeah, we hate them, right? We hate these darn things, but you can take pictures with these things. You can take pictures of runs. You can take pictures of bugs. You can take pictures of the weather conditions. You can do everything on these things and log everything in your trips, okay? And I recommend you do that. That's built into my tactical plan. Every time I do a trip report, every single time I go out, whether I'm guiding or I'm fishing, okay? That's for my log, so I can go back and look on that. Same as in law enforcement, when I do a report, okay? I know it's gonna go in front of lawyers. I know it's gonna go in front of judges, right? I better have everything in that report. Everything I did, everything involved in the situation to cover my butt, right? So I liken that to the same thing as I put it into the same deal as my reports, my fishing reports. Move it over, put everything in that report. All right, so we're going to talk about sectioning out the river when you get there, okay? Pie the river, all right? I liken this to when we're clearing a building, okay? Everybody's responsible for their own section as we go in, okay? We talk about it. We make sure everybody knows what they're doing, okay? If when you're got your pied section, when I look through it, if I miss something in that pie, what's going to happen? Somebody could get hurt, right? So I don't want to miss anything in that pied section that I have. Same with this. Systematically approach the river, okay? Use that pied section. Look at everything in it, break it down into smaller pieces, okay? Tactical angling partners, okay? This is a good one that I always liken to if you got a buddy at work, okay? We're going to get together and we can talk about this all the time, okay? We can section out the river together. I call it pie of the pie, all right? You can pick out a section and he takes a pie, you take a pie of that section, okay? We built that into our tactical plan beforehand, okay? We may come together halfway through the day and explain to each other, Okay, what happened in my section? All right, I had this hatch. I had this kind of fish. I had these fish were sitting up in the water column. We explain it to each other and then switch. Fish that section in different areas. Okay, now we built into the plan here, right? We get to the water. Okay, we got our sections all picked out. The run I picked out, come up over the hill. There's a person standing in my run, right? Oh, man. I'm going to run down there and shove him in the water, and I'm going to start beating him with this fly rod. No, we can't do that, right? We can't do that. So don't worry about people on the river, okay? Don't worry about those guys that stand in runs all day long, do that kind of stuff. Trust me, they miss fish. I go in behind people all the time when I'm guiding, when I'm fishing on my own, and there's plenty of fish, okay? You just got to change your tactics to match it, and you'll catch them, okay? So don't worry about people in those sections. When I'm also using a tactical partner, at the end of the day, we can come back, talk about that section, okay? Talk about what happened throughout the day, because, of course, everything progresses throughout the day on the river, right? We have all kinds of different things happening. So we can talk about that. And next time we come out, okay, we can take another section of river, okay, pie that section out. Same as if I'm on my own. I can take another section, but what I would always tell you is go back to that first section, fish it, and then move to your next section. That's how you learn the river, okay? That's how I tactically learn the river. So we're going to encompass reading water here a little bit, okay? I kind of liken reading water in my tactical plan to talking to people in an interview situation on a disturbance, something like that, okay? Everybody in life has, when I get to that disturbance, okay, there's probably 10 different problems going on, right? And then that problem has 10 different problems. And then before you know it, you got one problem and 30 million different problems, right? So when I go into the situation, I got to figure out what the one main problem is, okay, and get rid of all the rest. Okay, make them feel confident. Say, hey, I understand what's going on with you. We're going to break it down to this problem at this time. Okay, relating back to fly fishing, it's the same thing. If you look at the river as a whole, okay, it's kind of intimidating, isn't it? I got a million different sections. I don't know where to start. I'm going crazy here. Okay. You break it down to one specific situation, one specific problem that you're dealing with at that time, okay? I always say to observe the water, okay? You want to observe before you even get in, okay? There's so many times I see, we were just up on the Blue on Monday, and me and Chris, a guide that I guide with, a buddy of mine, we get out of the car, and the guys next to us are like, hey, they don't even have their waders on. And we were start laughing. We're like, we don't have our waders on. And we hear the dark car doors close, and they go running for the river, right? Just trying to beat us there. We just laughed because it was kind of funny, right? It was, see these guys take off running. So a lot of these things, we observe the water before we even get into it. I call it kind of getting in tune with the water. You say, this guy, he's been smoking too much of that Colorado happy weed, right? But here's the thing. When you observe before you go in, you're going to notice a lot more things. Okay, you're going to notice flashes in the water. You're going to know where fish are hanging in the currents. You're going to know these different types of areas that the fish are holding in. Okay, you're going to see that. You're going to hear it. I've been on trips before, and I've been rigging somebody up. Oh, over there, there's a fish just rose. The client will be like, yeah, I just saw that. How did you know? Because you get so in tune with that, that you start hearing, you start seeing things that you've never seen before, okay? So sit back, look, watch. Don't be such in a hurry to start fishing right away. I tell you, when I became a guide, everything opened up to me so much more than when I was actually just fishing every day. Because I don't fish when I guide. I sit back and observe water all day long. It makes you a better fly fisherman, okay? Different methods of fly fishing. When I pick those out, okay, I'm going to pick something, okay, to start out with, but I can choose it, and I don't have to stick with it, right? I have my options. Carry a couple different methods with you, okay? I carry 2-3 rods sometimes, every one of them rigged up with something different, okay? Makes for quick change. If you go on a trip with me, I'm gonna have several different rod setups because we may come across different situations that we're gonna poke out there and go after fish, okay? So that's another good option to have with you, is a couple different methods to move to, okay? So we're gonna go into different types of water that we see mainly on in rivers, okay? Riffled sections. This is up on the Colorado River, okay? You see this long stretch of water, those nice little ripples going through. That's food highway, right? Oxygen highway. Lots of food and oxygen in there. Great places for fish to hold, right? When I'm on the river, these guys make fun of me all the time. I try to think of being a fish. Where would I be sitting when I'm looking at a river situation? Where would I be holding? Where I didn't have to expend energy to get my food. Trout in general are lazy, right? They want to sit there and get as much food as they can without expending energy for it. So these are great areas to find fish. They're going to be holding down. Remember, in the top section of water is going a lot faster than just 6 to 8 inches underneath. Okay, that top section is moving probably 2 to 3 times as fast as that bottom section. Those fish are sitting in those bottom sections, just letting the food come to them. Coming up, grabbing, going back down. Okay, real simple. What I like to use in these areas are dry droppers and dry dropper rigs. Great areas to use these because you can fish top, middle, bottom all at the same time with a good swing out the back. Fish in these type of areas with the riffled sections and things like that, they love those flies swinging. Now you're going to tell me, Mr. Joe here, they tell us to get dead drifts and you got to be perfect, right? And you got to do this and you got to do that. No, not necessarily. Okay, some situations, yes, that requires it. These are some of the best areas, though, to break those common things that are always told to you, okay? So we'll cast up into the ripples here. We'll let those flies roll downstream in the dry dropper rig and then swing out at the back end, okay? We're going to throw that min downstream, let them swing, okay? Sometimes you can add a little twitch onto that, get that upper bug moving a little bit. Okay, sometimes that'll trigger strikes. There's been times, especially on smaller creeks, you get a ripple section like that and you twitch it out the back end, those fish will literally come out of the water and jump on your top bugs. Okay. I also use a nymph rig in here. Okay, a lot of times I'm not using nymph or indicator rigs in here. If you've ever noticed, and I don't know if you guys have, but a lot of times that movement in those ripples with an indicator rig throws you off a little bit, okay? If you run a nymph rig through there, straight to your line, okay? This is kind of your Euro styles, but we've been doing this for years, right? With a fishing without indicator, okay? Letting it go through the current, getting under that top current, fishing that section where those fish are holding most of the time. We're watching the end of our line to straighten out, okay? And then we set the hook. A lot of times you're gonna pick up hits a lot more accurate with that straight line technique than you would on an indicator system. Not all the time, but it's a good method to have. That's a lot of times what I use. Well, I will fish clients all the time with indicator rigs, but the difference is when you're doing that is we want to take that indicator or the weight on there and adjust, okay? We want to make sure that weight is punching through the upper water column and getting down to that lower section. Okay, so in ripple sections, I tend to add a lot more weight. Okay, a good place to run streamers as well. Okay, we'll run streamers. You can dead drift them through these sections. Let them just dead drift. Watch for your line to straighten out. Let it swing out the back end. Get a few strips in there. See if you can get anything to follow. So at the end, I always, a lot of times, will try and run streamers through these areas because you never know what you might pick up, okay? And it's a good indicator if they're feeding out in these ripples and they're chasing streamers, it's a good indication that they might follow that in other areas that they're on the streamers. Shelves and drop-offs, okay? This is up on the Miracle Mile in Wyoming. That's quite a drop-off and shelf right here, right? Okay, it's a real big section of river. Okay, the shelf here is up on top just before it drops into that deeper water. Okay, a lot of times fish will sit up underneath that shelf and just wait for the food to come. Okay, sometimes they'll be a little bit further back sitting on that drop off waiting for food to come. Great areas to find fish. Okay, these areas I like to use indicator rigs a lot because I want to hold those flies in certain areas, especially coming down into these drop offs. Okay, I want to cast up onto the shelf, let it drop into that deeper drop off right where those fish are sitting. Key here is weight, okay, more than anything. You want that weight dropping down on the shelf so it gets down by the time it gets into that deeper section of run, okay? Dry dropper rigs are great in this area. A lot of times you can trigger strikes by throwing that dry dropper into these shelf areas because a lot of times these areas are holding so many fish, okay? It's a great area to pop a dry in there. And streamers, once I've fished through this section, a lot of times I'll come just above it a little bit and I'll strip streamers back across, right across their faces on those drop-offs. Okay, that's a great area to get fish chasing. Or cast into the back part of the deeper slot and pull them back up towards the front. Sometimes you can pull some of those non-feeding fish in the bottom of those drop-offs. They'll trigger them to eat, okay? Next one's tailouts and eddies, okay? This eddy section, the tailout section, we'll start off with the tailout section, sorry. So that's that section of water when it comes back out of the deep part of the run and goes back into the fast water, okay? There's kind of that lip that you see. You see the deep water and then it kind of... the tailout section. A lot of people pass up these sections because they think those fish aren't feeding, okay? You'll see a lot of fish sitting right back on that shelf looking up for food coming over their head. It's the same thing as the drop-off. They're just sitting on the shelf waiting for food to come back out of the run, okay? So in these situations, indicator rigs are great. Nymph rigs are great. This is an area where I like to get those flies down in the deep part of the run. And then throw that min downstream, letting those flies come up and ride that shelf up. Fish in general, especially trout, they're going to be sitting on that lip, okay? As those flies come up from that deep water back up to the top, it looks like they're emerging, right? That triggers their natural instinct to eat, okay? Bug emerging, go get it, okay? So that's a great area to swing your flies to the back of the run. Okay, especially with those indicator rigs, even giving a little strip or two, a small little strip across the back end of that tailout is great options. Same with dry dropper setup, letting that swing into the back end of the sections instead of just total dead drift through there. A lot of times a little bit of English on there, a little bit of wrist action. Get those fly, that top fly popping a little bit. It's also going to move your bottom flies underneath it as you go through there. Anything triggering that movement of them emerging is going to get those fish to go in those sections. Okay. Eddy situations, some of the hardest to fish. Anybody fished eddy sections? They're pretty tough, right? Okay. This is another area to break down. Okay. So when I'm fishing indicator rigs and things like that, I'll come off the main current, let them turn in there a little bit, okay? That eddy section backing off into the current on itself, okay? So that current comes off the main channel, turns, and then goes back into the main river section again, okay? So in there, you got a ton of different currents, and your flies aren't always in the right position for those fish to eat. Sometimes you're too deep, sometimes you're too heavy, sometimes... You got to figure out with weight and depth where that right line is where those fish are sitting. A lot of times in the eddy parts of these runs, they're sitting looking back this way or they're looking this way, okay? So they could be staring right at you and you don't even know it when you're on this side of the river, right? So they can see you before you're even coming, all right? So you almost have to fish that at a different angle, okay? You have to come up above it, come off the main channel, and let your flies ride into that section, okay, with indicator rigs. Incorporating some strips and pauses, can always help, all right? But main thing you want to remember with your indicator rigs and your nymph rigs in these sections is weight. Same thing without indicator. Instead of letting that ride the current, just raise and lower your rod tip a little bit. That'll change the fly position in the column. The fish will tell you if it's right or not, okay? The trick is with that is remembering where you were at, what you were doing when that fish hit, right? Okay? And then we'll also run streamers through these sections. It's a good place to run streamers because a lot of times those fish get on the bottom and they're looking up through those currents at the sections. You run a couple streamers through there, get that motion going, it'll trigger them to strike a little bit. Okay? In any situations, you got to change your position around it. Find what works. Don't just go above it. Don't just be on the side of it. Don't just be behind it. Work all the way around that eddy position, okay? Next section's pocket water. We all love this stuff, right? Oh, goodness. It's hard to walk in. There's so many different areas to fish, right? Pocket water is tough, okay? But pocket water, there's so many different sections to fish in this, okay? A lot of times I don't fish indicator nymph rigs in here, okay? Because there's so many changes of current, there's so many different things. I'm not saying you can't, but if you do, you got to break it down in kind of a grid pattern, okay? Break down each individual little riffle. Change your weight, change your depth for each one of those sections. If you're not doing that, you're not going to catch much in these sections, okay? Trust me. But you see, these type of sections, all this white stuff, oxygen, right? Tons of food around all these big rocks. There are fish in these sections. A lot of times, you're not going to be able to sight fish in these sections, okay? These are where the Euro guys and all these guys with the fancy European stuff, right? This is where they make their money, water like this, because they're getting down underneath all those currents, and they're fishing those areas where most people don't fish, okay? And there's plenty of fish to be had there. Okay, a lot of times I start out with in these sections dry dropper setups. Okay, I can run different currents. I can run those areas through. The dry gets them looking up a little bit. They also see your droppers, things like that. That's one way I look at it, is starting with that dry dropper setup. Nymph rigs without indicators are good. Okay, right? Our Euro styles, things like that. A lot of times in these sections, I'm using those same bugs that they're using, okay? I'm using those jigged hooks. I'm using different things like that. Hook points up, so I'm not getting a ton of snags every time I swing through there, okay? You can dead drift through these sections. You can swing out into these sections. A lot of times in these areas, I'm looking for my biggest fish to pick out. I'm looking in front of rocks, okay? There's a pillow section in front of that rock where the current breaks around it. A lot of times your biggest fish are sitting right in front of those rocks right there, okay? Great places to find them, okay? Grid this out. Make sure you cover each and every area, okay? I'll start at the back, come across, come back out, start the next section, grid it out, work my way across, come back out, move up. If you want to systematically fish that, that's how you do it, and you're going to catch your most fish by breaking it down that much. Okay, that's my tactical plan for all these different types of water, is I want to break each one down individually, okay? Staying sharp, okay? So it's a constant learning thing with fly fishing, right? We have to continue our tactical training all the time, okay? We want to put together that plan, how I'm going to relate it to my own life, okay, and how I'm going to look forward to that trip coming forward, okay? How I'm going to build that plan, everything from my equipment down to how I break down water, okay? Practice, that's the biggest thing. Go out there, not just with your equipment and casting and things like that, practice tying your rigs up. So many people, when I'm out on the water, I see them fighting with those rigs. Sometimes I feel bad for them. I go up to them and rig them for them, okay? Just because I don't like to see people struggling with that stuff. But if you take the time, you know, get you some line that you can work with, the cheap stuff from Walmart, and just rig up. Constantly rig up. the dexterity in your fingers and things like that, it will build as you go through where you can tie those things like nothing, okay? And then I can switch out my rigs quick if I need to, okay? Mental training, okay? Review your notes. Review that tactical plan. Adjust it. Change it to what you, maybe you're going to a different river system. Maybe you have to look at things different. Maybe stuff's not working. Adjust your plan. It's always evolving, right? Add new tactics to it. Things that I'm going to work on, okay? And go back over your notes, back over your reports, back through your pictures. Put them all together. Organize them, okay? So for the people at home, if you want to start building your own tactical plan, you can go here, Tactical Rivers 2016. You can pick up a copy of these slides and start developing your own tactical plan, okay? I want to thank the Blue Quill Angler for being here today and all you guys out there and you guys at home. I sure appreciate it. Cody, Steve, Brian Kelso, Mike, Jim, for setting all this great equipment up for me and putting this technical stuff together for me. Really appreciate it. I'd like to thank Ryan Ayers with Focus 53 for helping me put my presentation together, get my thoughts organized. Okay, and check out joeschaferflyfishing.com. And next up, we're going to move to the tying section if you guys want to see some bugs tied up. Any questions?
One question. In going through the different tactical approaches to different waters, you don't specifically mention seams.
Mm-hmm.
And that seems to me to be one of the critical places on the river, particularly the tailwaters.
Absolutely, yeah. Oh, can you repeat the question again? Oh, okay, so his, thank you. So his question was, I kind of left seams out in different river sections when I was going through that. And of course, seams are very important. The reason I kind of don't break those down individually is because, especially when I teach them to people, it's a specific look that I want people to see. Those are specific areas that I kind of target. So I'll point those out and show them how to fish. Like in these situations, say we got a seam coming off of a major current, a bubble line in there, right? A lot of times how I'll approach it two different ways. I'll put a dry dropper set up through there, and I'll put a small little emerger. I'll shorten up a little bit because I know that there might be fish in that upper section. So I just want to drop below that surface film, get it in that section, or I'll put two behind it. Okay, and I'll fish that seam like that. Or I'll run that indicator rig through there, making sure my line is adjusted to the right depth. Because I'm sure like you've seen before, fish tend to hold in those areas in different parts of the column. And a lot of times you can see them. If you look underneath those folds coming out of the main current into that seam, you can see fish and where they're holding underneath them. So, of course, yes, that's one section that I didn't break down specifically. But that's a lot of times areas that I'll specifically point out on the river. A little hard to show in a slide situation, but yes, absolutely.
One thing I've noticed, and not all of them, some of them, and I don't have anywhere near the experience, is that the fish often knows more in that area, rather than really rising or making. Right.
I definitely think you're onto something there, because a lot of times in those areas, I think more than anything is they're targeting specific hatches. They're targeting specific bugs that are coming downstream. They're not sitting in the bottom of the run just being, whatever comes by type thing. They're specifically targeting food, and I think you're right on with that. Another question.
Based on the conditions of the river, but I'm wondering if there's a sort of a systematic process you go through to say, try this, and then try this, and then try this, and try this, just to get a general feel for what might be working.
Absolutely. I actually did an article on my site specifically about that, fishing new water. And what I tend to start out with, excuse me, So he's asking if there's a specific technique, specific way that I approach like a new section of river that I go into. Just last week or a couple weeks ago, I'm a guy at a new section of water on the Yampa. So I had never even seen this section of water up there. So how I approach it is I did my tactical plan, like you said, put it together. I got there and I was like, oh no, you know, it's totally different than what I thought it was and what it looked like on camera. So what I had to do is stop and think first and say, hey, how am I going to break this down? So I'm going to go to the lowest point of the property where I want to start. Okay. That's how I'm going to start out first. I'm going to find my run that I want to fish, and I'm going to start specifically with that run and break everything down in that run. So I'm going to start with an indicator rig in that situation, and I'm going to find out what they're going to eat first. Okay. So, and I'll change my bugs up according to that. Okay. And as soon as I find what they're eating, then I can change my tactics from there. A lot of times too, when I break that down, especially going to a new section of water, I want to do a seine. I want to check the bottom of the river. I want to check and see exactly what is living in that situation. Turn over some rocks, okay? I want to match the size, shape, and color, okay? That's basically what I'm looking for. Shape being whether it's midge, caddis, that type of thing, right? And I'm very glad you brought that up. So when I match that, then I know that I'm in the ballpark at least, right? So that's what I'm kind of looking for. Is I'll take that same first thing off, make sure I know what's going on, and then I'll break down those sections even more, and then I can start working my plan after that. Does that answer your question? Yeah. Great. Any other questions?
Just a very simple question having to do with the indicator position. Mm-hmm. 1.5 to 2 times the depth of the water. Are we talking about indicator to the weight?
Bottom fly. That's how I do it, is to the bottom fly. But with my bottom flies, I have a lot more distance a lot of times than most people, or I shorten them up even more than most people. So it depends on in that rig how I go for it. Okay. What I typically do is I measure with my arm. Okay. So if I know that's 3 feet, okay, I'm going to measure 1, 2, 3 on my line, and that's kind of where I judge it from. Okay. I'll put my line up to my arm because I know it's about a foot long. So that's kind of how I start off, but I never go by that, hardly ever. It's funny because I change and lower to the fish when I'm seeing in the water, okay? If they're up, I'm going to move that indicator down. If they're down, I'm going to move that indicator up, okay? I'm following the fish. That's where I want my flies to be constantly, okay? Even when I'm not using an indicator, I want my flies to be right in that position. Now, without an indicator, you have to use your weight more, right, to adjust that to the different sections. But with that indicator, I'm trying to hold those fish in that section, or hold those flies in that section those fish are mostly feeding, okay? And if I can't see into the water, I just keep adjusting that indicator till I find where I'm getting a lot of hits, okay? And then I'll keep that indicator in that same slot. Does that make sense?
Yeah, I just think the weight's going to be on the bottom. The weighted fly will be down, the mm-hmm. waters will be higher up, so you yep. can have it to the fly be your distance.
Right. I always go a little bit shorter, though, because in my situation, what I want to do is I also incorporate the flow with it, too. So depending on how that's coming down, I will lengthen and lower for that. And I totally see what you're saying. Yeah, you can go to the fly or to the weight, but I always account for the extra flow and things like that are happening. It's a little bit different than some people, but that's how I do it. Anybody else?
Do you have any experience with using the CDC as indicators?
No, I really haven't used it. Oh, he's asking if I have much experience with using CDC for indicators. I use polypropylene yarn almost exclusively. I just think that that's the best stuff. You know, a lot of times I don't have time to be messing in certain situations with different tactics. I kind of, especially when I'm guiding, I want to stay with what I know and get those people into the basic situations that they're going to see most often and start them out in that. So, and a lot of times, even more and more as I go along, I'm not using indicators as much. So I'm switching my tactics to move on to do different things. The other indicator I will use is a thingamabobber. But I rigged that up a little different too, so.
I've had enough trout trying to eat the thingamabobber.
Exactly.
It seemed to me that replacing it with something like a CDC fly.
There you go.
Not necessarily a bad idea.
Or maybe I should be fishing dry dropper dropper, right? Or something like that. Totally makes sense, absolutely. So that kind of gives you, that's a good, great example. You see a lot of times them coming up for things. Well, shoot, why am I not fishing dry dropper dropper? Same thing with the yarn indicator a lot of times, especially when I cut them down to real small, if I know the fish are spooky. A lot of times you'll have them coming up hitting that. What's that tell you? Change my way of thinking here, right? I'm going to change my plan here. I'm going to switch dry dropper dropper and let's get after this, right? Same way of thinking. Any other questions? Great. Thanks for coming out, guys. Thanks for everybody at home for watching. And if you have any questions afterwards, come see me. Thank you. All right. So we're going to do a little tie-in here if you guys want to stay and see that.